For our first walk today, we travel to Tottiford Reservoir. This beautiful, picturesque area is popular with walkers and fishermen alike. From the car park, we follow the road to Tottiford Farm and turn into Neatencleeve Wood, past Cannantine Down and into Birchcleeve Wood. Then it's on to Fleetwood Plantation, following the road past Beasley Copse, Higher Plantation and on to Bannock Hill. Then it's down into Christow. From there, it's up to Bowden Farm and on to Clampett Plantation, Kennick Reservoir and back to Tottiford Reservoir, a distance of approximately 8.5 miles. We join our walkers in Beeden Lane, heading for Tottiford Farm. Then turning into Neatencleeve Wood. There aren't too many wild flowers showing yet, but as always, the gorse flowers are a picture. One of the little known tours of Dartmoor is on screen now. Great Rock Copse Tour. It is in the wood below our track. We pass the Leet water supply for the Cannantine Falls. Originally, this supply served the sawmills and mines in the area, but was redirected by Lady Exmouth at the end of the 19th century, and the falls bears her name.
Sun's come out at last. Brilliant.
This pathway through the forest is about 3 miles long. At times, it can get a little monotonous. It is, however, time for a coffee break, and the adjacent woodland is an ideal place.
Primroses.
Once out of the woods, there is a little road walking before turning off and heading for Higher Plantation.
Another turning right here.
Lovely enclosed pathway. Really nice to get out after being cooped up for so long. To come a bit further afield is beautiful.
Ladder styles
nice out in the open a bit.
Can sometimes be really easy to get over, and other times they can be really difficult and occasionally dangerous.
You're on camera now, we'll see you made it difficult.
We're now heading for the village of Christow, and we're soon at Benner Hill, which is quite steep. It leads to the hamlet of Benner before descending down into Christow itself.
What's that there?
It's got a little grass bank at the top of her gate and all the dogs go.
So what was that you were looking with binoculars?
Christow. Or part of it at least, anyway.
But before Christow, as I said earlier, is the small but very quaint hamlet of Benner.
That's a nice little spot.
Nice stone one.
Periwinkles.
As a Devon village, Christow is one of my favourites.
The centre of Christow.
And during better times, I have eaten several times at the local pub. The access route from this point is quite obscure and can easily be missed. It is a small pathway behind the local gardens, and the wood it goes up through is a very pretty part of our walk.
It's lovely going up through here. Really fresh, no wind.
Fantastic. Wood anemones are just starting to show here, but they're difficult to see in this light though. The only drawback on this route through the woodland is stiles, quite a few of them.
Making our way back up towards the reservoirs now.
With small groups of people, getting over them doesn't take too long, but with larger numbers of walkers, then it can take quite a while. The stream is sourced from a small lake at the Bowden farm, which eventually discharges into the River Tee. The valley we're walking up is between Bowden Beer and Cleve Hoe. Quaint names for a beautiful area.
Lunch.
It's just about lunchtime, and we couldn't pick a better place. After lunch, we have more stiles to get over. Two in short succession here. Our route continues in an upward direction, walking alongside the stream. But now, it's a little steeper.
Quite steep heading up here.
And yet another ladder style. Joan finds a way round it though. We're still climbing, but the route through the woods in the sunshine is very pleasant. Only one more stile to go.
I remember this bit.
Up another dirt track.
Following an upward rising broad muddy track, we eventually arrive at Bowden Farm. I've looked for the lake that's supposed to be here several times, but it must be hidden by the farm buildings. We always try to have a chat to the locals if we get the opportunity. You can learn a lot about the area doing this.
We're not far to go.
Yeah, not much farther.
No, definitely not much farther.
Drink and dinner, you're all right.
Yeah. Have a nice walk.
On you.
But as an observation, a horse could do with a good grooming though. There follows a little more road walking before the roadway becomes a track. We're heading towards the reservoirs. There are some isolated houses and farm buildings here, but I'm not sure I would like to live this far out though. We're shortly coming up to where a plaque refers to the Society of Quakers, the Clampett Burial Ground, 1674 to 1740. Elias Tuckett was the first to be buried here in 1687. The last registered burial was in 1732. It's thought that many other unregistered burials took place.
Don't tell them about the hole behind them.
We're now walking through the Clampett plantation and we'll shortly reach the road down to Kennick Reservoir. Several trees seem to have been toppled during the winter storms.
24 people, couldn't it?
Yeah, it's like baby
food. Now walking down towards...
For those who are interested, some facts and figures regarding the reservoirs. Kennick, Tottiford and Trenchford reservoirs covers four parishes, Bridford, Hennick, Christow and Lusley. Constructed in 1861, Tottiford is the oldest reservoir on Dartmoor, followed by Kenwick in 1881 and Trenchford in 1903. Between them, they hold 2,156 million litres of water.
It certainly can.
For the people who like their measurements in imperial, 474 million gallons.
It's lovely now.
Work's uniform on, trying to keep my phone dry. Oh, the bloody fish go.
Again, for those who are interested, fishing is high on the list for all the reservoirs. Trenchford is a pike fishing reservoir, Tottiford is for carp, and Kenwick for trout.
We've got campervans packed away in side streets.
Tottiford Reservoir seems quite full, and in places the pathway is very close to the water's edge.
Gorse here, I should say. Lovely.
The gorse flowers look good and smell good. The coconut is quite intoxicating.
Such a fantastic old tree. We're nearing the end of our journey now. About another 400 or 500 yards, we'll be back in the car park. It's been an absolute cracking morning. Superb. With all this lockdown business, when you get out here, everything seems to fade away. Oh, lovely. Tottiford Reservoir.
It's now wall-to-wall sunshine, and this seems a fitting end to a very pleasant morning's walk. Our next walk starts a few miles from here, on Trendlebere Down. For our next walk, we have a more open moorland route, at least for the greater part of this walk. From the car park, we head down towards Hisley Bridge, turning and walking up through the valley and in a loop around Trendlebere Down, crossing the road and skirting Black Hill. Then it's on to Smallacombe Rocks and over to Hay Tor, before following the granite tramway around and down to Yarner Woods. Then it's up through the woods and back to the car park, a distance of about 8 miles. From the car park, there are great views towards Lusley Cleeve. The route down to the main path is a little tricky. It's well worn and weathered.
Quite steep going down here.
And it's not an easy descent, at least for the first part. Once onto the main track, leading to Hisley Bridge, it's fairly easy until you get to the bottom. Then it's an uphill trek.
I'm going to turn left here. Quite a steep trek up this valley.
The route up through to Trendlebere Down is fairly straightforward, following a stream, but it is a little strenuous, rising nearly 200 metres. There is an alternative route from the car park, which follows a path alongside the road before cutting down to cross the stream further up the valley. But today's route is a little more challenging.
We carry on upwards. Pine tree that's seen better days. Just about had it, I think. Flatter part of the walk before going up again.
At this point, you do know you've walked up quite a steep track. The top part of this rising track up through the valley is a little more obscure, picking your way around fallen trees, with a small shortcut up the end, which leads on up to the down.
Forever upwards at the moment. Me? Painting. We seem to have lost the people in front of us at the moment.
The loop across and around the down is easy to follow.
Beautiful.
But it's not an even track, very tufty. Eventually, we reach the road.
A lusty cleave in front of us. And then we continue upwards towards Black Hill now. It's a bit torturous through the gorse here. And you wouldn't want to do this late on in the season when all the bracken's up. But at the moment, it's okay. Wow, that's tough coming up there. 2.24.
I expect all those watching have noticed that this is all uphill at the moment. This continues until we get up to the track that leads to Smallacombe Rocks.
What a cracking view behind us. It's so good to get out onto the moor again. I'm going to have a cup of coffee in a minute, I think. Everyone's suffering a little bit, not having been on too many of these types of walks for the past 12 months. Black Hill over to the left. Makes such a difference when the sun comes out.
The good news is that the second half of the walk is mostly downhill. I said mostly.
Just had a break. Now to continue with the walk.
There is always a fair amount of discussion between our walkers about what the various tours and other features are that are set out before them. We'll shortly be making a left turn and head up towards the main path between Black Hill and Smallacombe Rocks.
Hound tour. Look at that, lovely. Looking out towards Hain Down and over to
Coming out onto the path beside an unnamed group of rocks, Haytor is right in front of us. Parts of the pathways leading to Smallacombe Rocks are really well worn and weathered, but it's hardly surprising as this is a very popular area for both walkers and animals alike. The Granite Tramway. We'll be following this well-known feature after our visit to Haytor. However, there are some threatening clouds above us. Hope the rain holds off.
We're heading up towards Haytor. Just for a change. Ah, it doesn't matter. We've done this hundreds of times. But what difference does it make? We're out and we're out on the moor. And that's really all that counts.
We're approaching probably the most well-known tour on Dartmoor, and definitely the most visited.
Hey, tour.
One of its most fascinating facts are its previous names, some of which are set out on screen.
Back down from Hey, tour, and heading for back onto the Granite Railway.
We now follow one of the most well-known features of this part of the moor, and I will give you a few facts and figures about it shortly. I think most of us know that this granite tramway was built to convey granite from Haytor down to the Stover Canal and then on to Tynmouth Quay. I'll continue shortly.
Hello.
These white ponies are likely to be hill ponies, which are ponies born on Dartmoor, but not a purebred registered Dartmoor pony. I'm not sure what's wrong, but they do look very lethargic. This small youngster may qualify as a true Dartmoor pony, but I'm only really guessing. Now, let's get back to our granite railway. Built in 1820, the granite was in demand in the developing cities of England as masonry to construct public buildings and bridges. In 1850, the quarries employed over 100 men, but by 1858, they were closed due to the availability of cheaper Cornish granite. The Haytor Rocks and Quarries are now protected from development and disturbance as a site of special scientific interest. We are still following the granite tramway. A layer of earth has covered the tracks up over the years, but every now and again, it reveals itself.
All right. Hey, mate, how you doing?
We are reminded that we are not the only people using this track.
Hello there.
A gap in the trees gives us a good view down towards Bobby Tracy and the road coming up to Haytor. We're gradually making our way down to the edge of Yarna Woods, and the pathway starts to get a little more enclosed. Many walkers from our local group will know this route, having bespoke gates to stop mountain bikes using this part of the track, which is leading into Yarna Woods. Eventually, we reach a point where we need to make a choice of which way to return to the car park.
Got a couple of choices now, either that way or down through the Yarna Woods, and I think we'll go this way today.
There are numerous ways through the woods, and some are a little complicated. It's just a case of exploring and finding which way would suit you. The good thing is that the pathways are generally broad and well defined. There are many carvings, bespoke seats and notice boards telling you what your position is and the history of the local area.
Hello.
We do meet other groups of walkers, but not that many. The weather conditions in the woods change dramatically, going from sunshine to rain, and then to snow, and then back to sunshine.
We've had everything this morning.
Eugene, 300 yards in front, has now come back to the fold.
This part of Yarna Woods is a little less known, and the tracks are not quite as well defined.
She's coming back. We shouldn't allow her to come
back. The last
back.
Track leading up to the gate and onto the main west to east route through the woods is in parts worn away, but it's still okay. To be really honest, there is a choice of routes leading to the gate in question. I've probably chosen the worst one. We now follow this main west to east route for a short distance before crossing the road from Bovey to Manaton and taking a track on the other side. We are now on part of the track that forms the alternative route I spoke about earlier. We're coming to the end of our two walks. It's been a brief look at both of them. The only way to get the full benefit is to do the walks yourselves. Those who would like a GPX route file, just subscribe or get in touch with Newt Navet Ramblers. Thank you for watching. Bye for now.